Hear the word of God. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. I will ask the Father, and he will send another companion who will be with you forever. This companion is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor recognizes him. You know him, because he lives with you and will be with you. I won't leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Soon the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you will live too. On that day you will know that I am in my Father, you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them loves me. Whoever loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. Let us pray. Come, Holy Ghost, our souls inspire, and lighten us with your celestial fire. For if you are with us, then nothing else matters. And if you are not with us, then nothing else matters. Be with us, we pray, in the name of your beloved. Amen. I blame the writer of John. I blame the writer of John for the only bad grade I got in my preaching class in seminary. I blame the writer of John because it is only in John that we read about the Holy Spirit who will be sent to the disciples as an advocate and companion after Jesus is gone. In the passage following today's scripture, it says, "I have said these things while I am still with you." Jesus is speaking to his disciples. "I am still with you, but the advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom God will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you." The preaching assignment was to preach on something that was challenging. And some people chose to preach on something that was pastoral care challenging, such as preaching at an infant's funeral. So that was the tack they took on this preaching assignment of something difficult. I thought I would go the theologically challenging route and preach on the Holy Spirit, which is something I struggle with even today, preaching on the Holy Spirit. I can preach on Jesus, I can preach on God. The Holy Spirit is hard for me. And so I studied the scriptures and I built on my confirmation and Sunday school knowledge, and I said in the sermon, I said, you know, the Holy Spirit was moving across the waters from the beginning of time. And in Genesis, we read about the Holy Spirit moving across the waters. And it was around all through the Hebrew scriptures. And then when Jesus came, the Holy Spirit was focused on Jesus and was just there, right in Jesus. And Jesus showed the Holy Spirit through his actions and through his words and through his teachings. And then, because of this passage in John, then the Holy Spirit, when Jesus left, it went whoosh, back into the world again. Well, it was a great sermon. I thought it was biblical. I thought it was brilliant. I thought it was breathtaking. My preaching professor, however, wrote notes on my script, and he said, with circles around those places where I had clearly said that the Holy Spirit wasn't anywhere except in Jesus when Jesus was around, like, no, not even in the next neighborhood, it was all in Jesus. He said, "Good delivery, bad theology." With circles and question marks around those questionable spots. Today's scripture is from the farewell discourse. It happens during the Jesus' time with his disciples. It starts with the foot washing, and then they're still at the Last Supper, what we've come to know as the Last Supper, and Jesus is telling them all the things that he wants them to know. And the farewell discourse in John lasts from John 13 to John 17. It's a lengthy speech, and he is telling them everything he wants to know. He wants them to know. He's with them at his Last Supper, and he knows he's going to die, but they haven't completely caught on. And he wants to make sure that they know all these important things before he dies. What would you say to your family and friends if you knew your time here was limited? If you knew you might not have another chance? What would you want to be sure they knew before you parted from them forever? Bud knew he was dying. Nobody in the room was saying it, but he knew that he was dying. He had been on dialysis for years. He had had a few setbacks in his health over the years, but he always bounced back. In the last year that preceding this visit I was having in the nursing home, he had been in the nursing home half a dozen times. And I chatted with him, I chatted with his wife and his son who were in the room, that we talked about a variety of things, and then I offered a prayer and was going to leave. And Bud, with his big working man hands, grabbed my hand with a vice-like grip and said, "I have always appreciated you, Pastor. I have always enjoyed your sermons, and I really appreciate you a great deal." And I could tell by his words that he was saying goodbye. And I wasn't ready. I wanted to say, "No, Bud, you're not dying. Come on." But the Holy Spirit intervened, and I said, "I have really appreciated knowing you. And what a good husband you have been to your wife, Evie, and to your sons, and to her sons. And what a good example you have been in our congregation. And I always appreciated shaking your hand at the back door, because you always had something to say about what you got out of the message, or some story that you really appreciated." And I said, "I knew that when you didn't comment, that the sermon just didn't hit you in the right way, or wasn't for you." And he said, "But they were always good." I said, "Well, I hope that I have a good one the next time you're back in worship." And he squeezed my hand, I squeezed his, and I left. Bud died the next day. And I hope that he was able to say to all of those who came into that room, and I'm sure he was, he just kind of took control. He was able to say what he needed them to hear before he left. John wrote his gospel to impart some truths, to share the story of Jesus' life in such a way that we may, as it says in John 20, come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing we may have life in his name. Jesus says to his disciples that he is going away, but he's sending the Holy Spirit not only to be with Jesus' followers, but to be an advocate, like a lawyer who helps you navigate through the complex and difficult court system. He wants to encourage the disciples that they will not be orphaned, that they will not be abandoned once Jesus is gone. These disciples who have grown fond of Jesus, who have seen him as a mentor and leader and perhaps even a father figure, will not be left alone to fend for themselves. The advocate, the Holy Spirit, will lead them. As a community of faith, the disciples have come to see themselves as a family of sisters and brothers in the faith, born of water and the Spirit, with God as their parent. The departure of Jesus did not change that reality. And this message is for us too. We are sisters and brothers in the faith. We are adopted by God as one of God's own. As it says in Ephesians chapter 1, God chose us in Christ to be holy, and destined us to be God's adopted children through Jesus Christ because of his love. We who have lived all our lives not being able to see a physical Jesus, but knowing that he is present in our lives, are not so shaken by an invisible presence as Jesus' disciples were. They had grown to expect that he would be physically present with them, and he had been their leader for 3 years. They expected it to be much longer. But that didn't happen. Jesus is trying to get them to understand that they are still children of God without even seeing Jesus in their midst. I was talking this week with a dad of three adopted kids, and he talked about their accomplishments as adults and how many things they are able to do, and he spoke with such pride as if he were their dad, because he was and he is. A couple of decades ago, on January 19th, 1995, my sister and brother-in-law, who were both in their 40s and had been trying for years to have a child, brought home their Russian daughter, Masha. And we welcomed her with open arms. There is something about an adoption, placing a child in need of a home with parents in need of a child, that is just especially electrifying and beautiful. When my sister first had Masha, many people would say to her, "Oh, how nice of you to adopt this poor girl who didn't have any parents into your family." And my sister would think, but she wouldn't say. Holy Spirit was intervening then too. What do you mean I'm being nice? This was completely my move, my desire to have a child. I adopted a child because I wanted to be a parent of a child, not because I felt sorry for those poor children. I wanted a child to raise as my own. In a similar way, we are adopted into God's family not because God feels sorry for us or needs to be compassionate on us poor sinners. God adopts us as children because God wants children. God wants the community of faith to be able to pass on the inheritance, to be able to raise as God's family. God adopts us and brings us into the family so we might be God's children. We are children in need of a parent, and God is a parent in need of children. We become heirs of God's rich fortune in this life and the next, as members of God's family. When you accept the fact that you are no longer orphaned, when you realize that you are loved by God and you are a child of God who has been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever, you understand that because of this relation, you are marked and claimed by the Holy Spirit to go forth and make a difference in this world. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the emphasis when talking about Jesus is to follow Jesus. In the Gospel of John, the emphasis is on having a relationship with Jesus. And just like any relationship, we need to nurture it with healthy communication and attention to how we can improve the relationship. How often do you talk to Jesus? How often do you talk to God? Do you pray before each meal, thanking God for it? Once before each meal, once maybe before you go to bed, once maybe when you wake up, 5 times a day, a minute of giving thanks to God for this life that you have been given. To remind yourself that you are not in this alone, that you are in a relationship with the one who created you. Our task is to invite the Holy Spirit to lead us and to be open for windows of opportunity, to be open to the whispers of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit often gives us inklings of what we need to do, of how we need to follow the Spirit's leading through nudges that we feel. We feel like we should be doing something. When we think of somebody we haven't thought of for years and wonder how they're doing, that is a nudge of the Holy Spirit, encouraging us to reach out to them. There's an old song that says, "They'll know we are Christians by our love." We are children of God, adopted into God's family, and we show membership in God's family by our love. By loving our partners when they are less than lovable. By loving and caring for that coworker, even when they unknowingly insult you. by looking for ways to bless our neighbors even when our neighbors do not bless us. That's what it looks like to show our love and show our membership in the family of God. Because the Holy Spirit's life and work can't be restricted into one person, even if that one person is Jesus. I've learned that since seminary. And the Spirit is way too big and powerful to be contained by any one of us. We are adopted by God, and the Holy Spirit works within us and through us as sisters and brothers in Christ, so that all may know God's love and know that they too are a part of the family of God. Let us pray. Lord, help me to be open to the Holy Spirit. Help us to have a daily relationship with you. Help us to be more loving and to help build up others. We pray that when people think of us as a church, that we may be seen as a serving community, that we are open to your Spirit, that we have a relationship with you, that we are defined by our willingness to help others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.